I rebuilt the entire Floatplane app in about 20 hours, and it has features the official app might not ever get. If new here, hey, I'm Coulter, and on this channel we cover everything from code, apparently, to retro handhelds, to modding consoles, and everything in between. So if that sounds like you, be sure to subscribe down below so you can catch our future videos. Today though, we're talking native iOS development, AI coding, and how I kinda accidentally built my favorite Floatplane app. So this whole thing started when Apple announced iOS 26, featuring Liquid Glass. Some hate it, I love it, and it's especially interesting because you can really only achieve that Liquid Glass effect by using the Liquid Glass rendering engine that Apple provides through their own raw SDKs. Essentially meaning you have to build an app natively and using Apple's dev tools. And so I'd flip between these beautiful new redesigned and simplified iOS native Liquid Glassy apps, but then I flip over to the Floatplane app on iOS and it feels just a little dated. Don't get me wrong, I get it. I think it's built in React Native and a lot of apps are, and that's a good call. But suddenly with Liquid Glass in play, cross-platform apps built with things like React Native feel just a lot more, I don't know, like a web page. That combined with, at least to me, some of the UX going on with the official Floatplane app where you tap into a creator and you kind of did a different style of page, and then there's the banner and this, it just seemed like there was a lot going on. And I just found myself craving a much more simplified interface that was blessed with the new Liquid Glass look to boot. And then I thought, hey, why don't I just build that myself? Now, I've never written a line of Swift code in my life, but I do respect it as a programming language, and I've learned through my dev career that's led me to being a present senior engineer that it's pretty easy to pick up a new language, especially if you have good reference material. And what's a better reference material these days than a little-known phenomenon, AI? Jokes aside, I was honestly just really curious to see how Claude Code, my preferred AI agent, would do its Swift development, and then if it was decent, I could just kind of learn Swift along the side as a starter project. And, spoiler, yeah, Claude's pretty good at Swift development. So first I started simple, just a very minimal toolbar at the bottom, home, creators, and search, steering into the clean Apple design language, nothing fancy, and using native Swift UI elements as much as I could for things like the video player, so I don't have to build a video player myself. But in doing so, I realized something. Now that I'm using these native Swift UI elements, I can suddenly add features to this app that aren't available on the official app. Adding things like picture-in-picture were super easy. Background playback so I can lock my phone while I listen to WAN show while I mow the lawn? Done. Adding a button so you can download videos for offline viewing? Surprisingly simple. And so pretty quickly I had a fairly solid feeling iPhone app with the majority of the functionality of the official app, and then I thought, hey, why stop there? I decided to open up the same code base, but on an iPad simulator, and I saw that, eh, the styles aren't too far off from supporting the iPad. So I slapped a grid layout in there that'll apply to iPad, so you can see more videos on the larger screen, of course. Moved around a few of the toolbar buttons here and there, and then all of a sudden it had iPad support, so that was cool. But then I got an even crazier idea. Now, I love using the Wasserflug? Not sure how you pronounce it, but thank you very much to the developer that made that, because my wife and I have been watching Tech Linked on it every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday morning for the last number of months, and it has worked wonderfully. However, now that I had this fairly solid code base of an app that can reach out to Floatplane and retrieve the videos and all that boilerplate, could I just add tvOS support to the same code base? So it turns out that adding tvOS support to an app is a lot harder than adding iPad support, and it did require me to rebuild entire screens in a tvOS version, especially things like the video player, since obviously the video player view is a lot different on TV than it is on your phone or iPad. Doing a lot of miming today, that's fun. But slowly but surely I was able to figure out the custom player buttons in the TV player, how to get a long press menu on each tile on the grid so that you get a little YouTube style slide out sidebar where you can like or dislike after you finish the video and it closed and you're like, ah, I meant to like it, Riley, I need to know your love. Ooh, and getting the comments and description to show in a sidebar while you're watching a video and making them scrollable, that was weirdly difficult, but we got that working too. So eventually this thing started feeling like a pretty solid Apple TV experience. Maybe not quite as polished as say like the YouTube app, but in the ballpark, I'd say. And what was really cool is this Apple TV version of the app ended up having features that the Wasserflug Floatplane TV client did not have, or at the very least that the App Store version doesn't have. I haven't tried the test light version, so maybe more features are hiding in there now, but just things like being able to view the comments on a video while I'm watching it, or like or dislike a video while I'm watching it, were really nice quality of life improvements that we've found we enjoyed while we've been watching Floatplane through the new FloatNative app. So at this point I was feeling pretty good. I had a very nice iOS 26 Liquid Glass feel on my iPhone, iPad support, a pretty solid Apple TV app to boot. But there was one particular feature of Floatplane in general that I expected when I first subscribed and have been a little annoyed it hasn't been there. and that is playlists. And not necessarily even advanced playlists, just a watch later queue where I can save videos from yesterday and videos from way back in the 2017 backlog, because as someone who subscribed to Floatplane just last year, there's a lot of cool exclusive content that I just got access to, and it's kind of hard to mentally keep track of all that stuff I want to eventually get around to watch. And it occurred to me that it's such a simple feature. You just need a database table somewhere with your Floatplane ID, your playlist ID, and a list of video IDs that are part of that playlist. And so I figured, hey, why don't I just build a supplementary API that I host separately from the main Floatplane API, and then I can simply layer these features in alongside the main Floatplane functionality. And that actually worked super well. The way I handled it was the user has to first authenticate via the regular Floatplane login, and then that token is used for them to authenticate with the supplementary API, then the supplementary API validates the token with Floatplane directly, and then hands them back an API key so they can talk to the supplementary API. This way, in that API, I don't have to store any personally identifiable information, just your Floatplane ID, your playlist IDs, and the video IDs you want to keep in there. So it's all clean and simple. And so after policing Claude into cleanly building that Node TypeScript Fastify API, and then integrating that into the existing code base, all of a sudden you can save to watch later, remove from watch later, create playlist, add to playlist, delete playlist. And I was like, dang, this is kind of a game changer of a feature. But that wasn't even the coolest part. As many of you may know who use Floatplane, the search is not the best. Luke has even talked about it on WAN Show, and it's just a bit of a known issue. Totally get it. I've never super minded it, but while developing this app, I was searching for a specific video. It was actually while I was adding support for non-video posts like text and image posts. And I was just trying to search for all caps SYW. And so I searched that, no results. Okay, well that's literally like the first three letters of three different posts on Floatplane. And so it should be treated as an individual word in the search index. I imagine some kind of Elasticsearch setup or something. But it started to really bug me that I couldn't find this video just by searching the first three letters of that video. And then I thought, hey, well, I already added the supplementary API, why not add a search endpoint to that API? And so all I really had to do was create a little script that will just back off on the rate limit, but just periodically call the Floatplane API to get all the metadata for all the existing posts in Floatplane for LTT, then save all the key metadata information for those posts in their own table in the supplementary API's database. And then I have a second script that runs every hour and just checks for new videos and adds it to that database. And so then all I had to do was add a little endpoint that just says, hey, if the search term is inside the title, send back the meta for those results. And in practice, yeah, I found calling this new search endpoint a lot more consistent than calling the existing Floatplane search endpoint. Granted, obviously this only works for LTT content because I've only subscribed to LTT on Floatplane, but because there are a number of other creators that host their content on Floatplane, I decided to make this feature optional by default and call it Enhanced LTT Search. And it'll only kick in if LTT is the only creator you've subscribed to and you've turned on the box. That way I don't block search from showing results from other awesome creators that use Floatplane. So I was riding pretty high, and that's when the authentication drama started. So initially, I created a cool little feature in the app that's called Automatic Reauthentication, which basically securely stores your username and password so that when your token expires, it can re-reach out, grab a new token for you, and you don't get kicked out like I do once a month through Wasserflug. Again, maybe they fixed that in the test flight build, but on the main build, I get kicked out once a month, and it's kind of a bummer. But then all of a sudden, I couldn't log into Floatplane at all through FloatNative. And I got a little worried. At first, I was almost sure that the Floatplane team had blacklisted me, even though I haven't really been hammering the API at all through this process and have been doing the same number of API calls as someone who's just scrolling through the list of videos available on Floatplane. So I decided to ease my worries by checking in with the LTT subreddit and see if anyone else had experienced anything with the V2 auth endpoint for Floatplane. And sure enough, other people were experiencing login issues in apps like Wasserflug, because the trick to making a third-party Floatplane client work is to use the V2 authentication endpoints that don't actually require you to provide a Cloudflare reCAPTCHA. But it appears that right toward the tail end of this project, the Floatplane team shut down the V2 authentication endpoint and solely allowed authentication through V3, which requires a valid reCAPTCHA response, which I cannot provide. And so I thought, well, shoot, was all this work for nothing? Like, do I just have to scrap the whole project or just throw the code out there and hope it goes to good use by the Floatplane team? Which we'll get to that in a second. But then I thought, well, hey, this doesn't have to be the end of the road, because all you need to access the Floatplane API is a valid token. Even if I won't be able to request a valid token through my app, I can at least let the user provide a valid token and then we can continue using the app just like we were, complete with the playlist features and clean UI and picture in picture and background play and all those cool features that I think people will want to enjoy on this app. And so I pivoted and added another login option to the login screen called token login, and by punch in, I mean paste, because it's like 20 characters long or something. And that little hotfix worked great until I wanted to try it on the tvOS simulator. And fun fact, you cannot paste into the Apple TV simulator, but instead are expected to type in all the little characters using the remote, at least for certain kinds of input fields. And there was no way I was gonna type in this entire massive token using the remote in the simulator or on my actual TV. And so one more very helpful reason to have that companion API in place, I added a QR code login option. And so now when you're logging into the Apple TV version of the app, the first thing you'll see is a QR code. And that QR code URL is a URL that was already generated by the companion API and sent back. So when you scan it, your phone will then open up a little FloatNative companion login page. And from there, you can much more easily paste in your token, and then the TV app will automatically receive that token and log in as normal. It sounds convoluted, but honestly, I had a lot of fun building this, as I've for some reason always wanted to build a QR code TV authentication system thing. And so, hey, what a great opportunity to do that, right? And like I said earlier, thankfully a Floatplane token seems to last about a month, so you won't have to log in with the token very often. So this is a pretty decent compromise given the situation. Now, at the start of this video, I said that I built this whole thing in 20 hours, and I believe that's correct in cumulative focus time from me, but obviously I had a lot of help, and this project probably wouldn't have happened if I wouldn't have been able to leverage Claude code to the extent that I did. And it also helps that I've spent a good chunk of this year really refining how to police Claude and get what I want out of it. And my mental tally of my time spent might be a little bit off, because there was definitely a lot of time spent vibe coding while watching Gilmore Girls with my wife, so maybe it's more like 30 hours, 35, I'm not sure, but it took about a month of off and on dev here and there, let's say. But here's the funny thing that I haven't really shared at all, is that I've actually tried to do this exact project for the Floatplane team for free for about a year. I actually reached out back in, I think last November. At the time, was looking around for new employment, but also just kind of wanted to collab with the Floatplane team and maybe for exposure for my then much younger channel. And I wanted to play around with Flutter because I was really hyped on Flutter at the time. And I think I reached out both through the Floatplane support form and the Become a Creator on Floatplane form, thinking those would get me a little more fast-tracked response, but actually got me crickets, which honestly, I get it. I was coming across as a more junior dev keener than a senior dev who just wanted to help a brother out. So no love lost there. And I heard very shortly after on Wansha that they hired a contractor to help out with their app situation kind of thing. So I figured, ah, stuff was already in the works. Oh well. But that desire to play around with the Floatplane API and build out a cool app for the TV and also a slick experience on the phone was always there. I had ideas of making an app called Goatplane, which was gonna be like half of what this project ended up being and also built in a much jankier tech stack. And so it feels really satisfying to now have Floatnative out there in the wild. At the time of this filming, I don't know if Apple approved the app, but it's either available for download in the description or available for download through test flight in the description. So it's out there either way. Hey, Future Coulter here. So funny enough, Apple did put up some roadblocks in Floatnative becoming public on the App Store, but not for the reasons I thought it would. I thought they would block it because it's a third-party client and I don't own Floatplane itself, but they actually didn't seem to care too much about that. Their main issue was that the app doesn't have in-app purchases in it, which would let them take a cut of the pie of your Floatplane subscription. Obviously, that problem is only for the Floatplane team themselves to solve. It would make zero sense for me to appease them and add in-app purchases to my third-party Floatnative app that would then make you pay on top of your Floatplane subscription. Like, no, we're not doing any of that. But because I'm not doing that, it also means that, of course, Floatnative won't be able to be on the public app store. And so instead, in the link in the description, I'm going to include a test flight invite URL. And how that works is you just need to install the test flight app from the app store. It's Apple's own app that's used for testing beta apps like this. And then when you tap the link in the description from your Apple device, it'll prompt you to accept the invite to test out Floatnative from within the test flight app. And yes, all these plain terms are getting rather confusing, I agree. But once you've accepted it, then you should be able to download Floatnative and enjoy it in all of its supposed glory. I'm definitely not claiming that the app will be bug-free. You probably will find one or two here or there. And if you do, there is a contact button in the settings page, so you can send me an email and let me know what you found. My speed of addressing those bug finds largely depend on if this becomes an open source project or if we end up doing something fancier with the code base. But either way, I hope you enjoy the app and that it accomplishes its mission of enhancing your Floatplane enjoyment experience on the go. And with that update out of the way, back to past Coulter. And just looking at the full feature set of this thing and how polished it feels, I'm really proud of how it turned out. And the funny thing is, I built this thing as if I was getting paid to do it. Like, sure, I was vibe coding, but I was vibe coding very carefully and very systematically, using lots of plans, forcing it to adhere to Apple design principles, iOS 26 best practices, giving lots of feedback to Claude so that it can make sure the code is clean and reusable and not repeating itself in places like vibe coding can sometimes do. And my hope is that this foundation is solid enough to just give it to the Floatplane team, free and open source, or however it best be transferred into your intellectual property bucket. I would love for this to be the official iOS and tvOS Floatplane app if you guys are down. So if anyone from the Floatplane team is watching this, or Linus, I know you're currently switched over to an iPhone Air, so maybe you'll appreciate the liquid glassiness of this thing. Any of you guys, feel free to hit me up and happy to chat. This project was purely a passion project I just wanted to have fun making and see if I could do it. And it's definitely not meant to step on the toes of the excellent talent on the Floatplane team. I love the service you guys are providing. Like I said, as a senior engineer, I completely get the struggle of roadmap and how cool stuff we want to fix just has to get bumped because there's higher priority things that we got to do right now. Resourcing limitations, like, I completely get it, and I'm not here to throw shade at all. I just happen to have the excitement and a bit of spare time to build this, and so I hope it's a blessing to you guys. But whether or not this becomes the official Floatplane iOS tvOS app, or even whether or not Apple approves it for an official App Store release, there should be a link down in the description for you guys to download and check this thing out for yourself. And if you do, definitely let me know in the comments what you guys think and what features I should have added or what features I shouldn't have added. Should I have stopped myself sooner, you know? I actually even explored adding official CarPlay support where you could have a CarPlay app and then summon up audio versions of videos while you're driving, but apparently that requires an extra layer of Apple approval, and I didn't think I wanted to push it, especially given that, you know, I don't own Floatplane. And if you Android bros are watching this, don't worry, I love Android too, and if you'd like to see an Android native port of FloatNative, then let me know in the comments, because I'm definitely not opposed to getting my feet wet in Kotlin as well to see what that experience is like making it a native Android app. To wrap it up, this was an absolute blast of a project to build. I had a ton of fun doing it, and if you like this video, you might like when I rebuilt a good chunk of the base Minecraft engine using just AI code, and I think it's still publicly available online, actually, if you want to try that thing out. And if you watch this whole thing, drop a seasonally appropriate Santa emoji in the comments so I know you watched this whole rant. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one.